Voting is what makes the difference. Voting is a privilege and it's a responsibility.
So when people say, oh, my vote doesn't matter, one vote, the power of one, can have an incredible difference in deciding the fate of millions.
It's very important for women to engage in politics because it gives you the ability to control your future, your destiny, by policies and legislation that controls every aspect of your life.
My advice to women in Cameroon would be, this is your right to vote. Exercise your right to vote.
I would say to the women of Cameroon to don't sit back and let the men do it all. You've got to get in there and run for office and know that you can do it, because it is possible.
Les élections de mi-mandat du 6 novembre 2018 aux États-Unis ont consacré la montée fulgurante des femmes au Congrès. Elles seront 95 à siéger à la Chambre des représentants sur un effectif de 435, 12 au Sénat qui en compte 100, alors que 9 des 50 gouverneurs des États sont désormais des femmes. La plus jeune du Congrès élue lors de ce scrutin est une démocrate, Alexandria Ocasio, âgée de 29 ans. Ancienne élue du Congrès où elle a siégé pendant 16 ans, Connie Morella apprécie mieux que quiconque ce qu'elle-même considère comme une évolution.
For the last election, we found more women elected than before. We previously had the year of the woman was like 1992, and this is when we elected 24 new women. Now we have over 100 in our House of Representatives and close to 30 in the Senate. So we've made great strides, and I think this past election was one that also energized young people, energized young women, and energized those who wanted to make a change.
Pour historique que soit le nombre record de femmes au Congrès, leur proportion ne dépasse cependant pas les 25% dans une société américaine qui pointe encore au 96e rang mondial en termes de représentation et de participation des femmes à la politique. Autant dire que le chemin est encore long, non seulement pour une plus grande représentation des femmes, mais aussi pour la prise en compte des problèmes liés au genre. Il faut tout de même reconnaître que les Américaines reviennent de loin.
And then at the time, which was like in the 70s, it sounds like a century ago, in the 70s, I was appointed to a commission to look at the status of women in my state and in the country. And I remembered that you could not get a credit card in your name if you were a woman without a male signing for you. And also, if you were to become pregnant at a job, you could be dismissed with no benefits. And you had certain occupations that were not open to women, an engineer, a doctor, an architect. But so I thought, well, yeah, this is not a level playing field for equity for people. And so I thought, well, maybe if I run for office, I will be able to change some of these laws.
Les entraves à une plus grande participation des femmes à la politique sont nombreuses.
First of all, I think women don't have the confidence that men do in running for office. I mean, why do we not have more women running? Well, we did this time, but traditionally we've not. It's like, oh my, I don't have the experience. I don't have the education. I don't have the money. I have a family. But it didn't bother men. I mean, a man in college could say, I want to run for Senate. But a woman would say, oh, I need to go through the little board and the municipality and whatever, and maybe I will do it later, you know. Or if they don't win, they don't run again. That is beginning to change. And I see that as something that is helping the whole country. I think it helps the world whenever you get women more involved, because then you can use their abilities. So I think lack of confidence. I think women have not always had the support that men had, the mentorships, the organizations that say, we are going to help you. Not only run, we're going to help you with what you're doing and pursuing.
Une centaine d'élus portera donc désormais la voix des Américaines au Congrès. On en est arrivé là grâce à un nombre tout aussi record de femmes investies par les Républicains et les Démocrates, soit 237 candidates pour la Chambre des représentants et 23 pour le Sénat. Elles jouissent ainsi du droit de vote qui leur a été accordé au bout d'un long combat, une lutte acharnée, une histoire de désobéissance.
I wish I knew how it would feel to be free.
Tout commence au milieu du 19e siècle. Rassemblée au sein de deux associations phares, la National Women's Suffrage Association et l'American Women's Suffrage Association, les Américaines réclament un nouvel amendement de la Constitution pour leur permettre de voter. Le Belmont Paul Women's Equality National Monument, situé ici à Washington, est un musée. Grâce à de nombreuses archives et documents historiques, il retrace la passionnante histoire de ces militantes féministes qui ont bataillé pour le droit de vote des femmes.
I wish you could know what it means to be me. Then you'd see.
So the National Woman's Party was really innovative in their tactics, and they will become, after Inez Mulholland's death in 1916, they try to take a petition to President Wilson, asking for him to back a federal amendment to the Constitution. He refuses to even see them. So as they're leaving, it's said that they come up with a plan. If he won't see their delegation, they will send him a delegation that he can't avoid seeing, that he will have to see on a daily basis. And so the next morning they get up and they show up at the gates of the White House with signs, and they stand out there from sunrise to sunset holding these signs, letting the signs do the speaking for them. And they do this 6 days a week for months.
Le combat se radicalise après la guerre de sécession. Quelques États commencent à accepter le vote des femmes, mais l'enjeu est de l'étendre au niveau national. La fin de la Première Guerre mondiale donne un coup d'accélérateur à la lutte. Le 19e amendement est voté le 10 janvier 1918 à la Chambre des représentants et le 4 juin 1919 au Sénat. La bataille est loin d'être gagnée. Il faut encore attendre que chaque État ratifie le 19e amendement de la Constitution pour que le droit de vote devienne une réalité pour toutes les Américaines.
In June of 1917, Russia is considering leaving World War One, pulling out of that alliance. They send an envoy to meet with President Wilson. The women will stand outside the White House with a sign speaking directly to Envoy Root, saying, you know, Envoy Root, when President Wilson says that we're fighting for democracy, he deceives you. 20 million American women do not have democracy here in the United States. You can imagine how that impacted the conversation.
Yes.
Exactly. So that night at the National Woman's Party headquarters, Alice Paul receives a phone call from the chief of police who says, any new protesters will be arrested.
Wow.
And she says, it wasn't illegal in January. It wasn't illegal in February. Why is it illegal now? And his response is, any new protesters will be arrested.
What you want, baby, I got it too. What you need too, you know I got it too.
In June of 1919, all of the hard work and all of the protests finally paid off, and Congress finally passed the Susan B. Anthony Amendment. Now, if this had just been a law, that would have been it. It would have been signed into law and they would have been done. But because this was a constitutional amendment, there was a next
very important critical step, and that was the ratification process. To become part of the Constitution, Congress has to pass it, but then 3/4 of the states also have to ratify it. And in 1919, with 48 states, that meant they needed to get 36 states to vote to ratify it. And it starts this process in June of 1919. There's a wave, a first wave of states trying to become the first. Wisconsin and Michigan, they ratify it on June 10th, just 6 days after the Senate passes it, each trying to be the very first state to get that designation.
Au 18 août 1920, la plupart des États ont ratifié le texte. Seul le Tennessee freine des quatre fers. Il finit in extremis par plier. C'est une seule voix qui permettra de faire la différence.
When they finally figure out who it was that voted and switched their vote, it was a young man by the name of Harry Byrne. He was the youngest legislature in the Tennessee legislature. When asked why did he change his vote, he pulled out an 8-page letter from his mother urging him to vote for women's suffrage. And he said, I thought about it. I thought about my widowed mother. I thought about how hard she worked to support us. And I thought about how well informed she was and how she stayed on top of things. And I thought, why shouldn't she have the right to vote too? So he changed his vote for his mother. And women's suffrage in this country came down to one vote. So when people say, oh, my vote doesn't matter, one vote, the power of one, can have an incredible difference in deciding the fate of millions.
Pour préserver ce droit qui leur a été accordé au prix de nombreuses humiliations et brimades, des associations dont le but est de renforcer la présence féminine sur le terrain politique aux États-Unis et de les éclairer sur les enjeux ont été créées. C'est le cas de la League of Women Voters. Nous sommes allés voir son bureau de Géorgie, basé ici à Atlanta, dans le sud des États-Unis. Tracy Atkinson en est la présidente.
The League of Women Voters registers people to vote, and we also educate citizens on different issues that affect their community and affect their everyday life. We also work to engage citizens in their government and in politics, sometimes with just education and training, and also by having civic forums within the community where they can meet the candidates that they're going to vote on and hear their platforms directly, or we can create an online candidate guide where they can go online on their computers and see who's going to be on their voting ballot that they're going to vote on.
La Ligue n'est affiliée à aucun parti politique. Elle s'emploie également à dénoncer toutes les mesures qui viseraient à entraver le droit de vote des citoyens.
The policies and laws that legislators make should be enabling and empowering and helping citizens have better access to vote, not making it harder. So when legislators create policy that erects roadblocks for citizens to vote, especially based on their color or where they're from or anything like that, or their sex. There's no reason for that. We're all one race, and that's the human race, and so our policies that are created by our lawmakers should make it more easy to vote.
Après bientôt un siècle de plaidoyer et d'activisme, la League of Women Voters se réjouit des résultats déjà obtenus.
Women made spectacular gains on all levels, on a municipal level, on the state level. Here in Georgia, we had women win seats in the state house and the state senate, and then in Congress, we had women run and win, And right now, our gubernatorial race is still not decided. So there is a chance that we could have the very first African-American female governor in the United States.
Au National Democratic Institute à Washington, l'on est aussi préoccupé par la problématique d'une plus grande participation des femmes à la politique.
We work to build the confidence and capacity of individual women through training and capacity building. We also work to remove institutional barriers through changes to political party laws, political party constitutions. So we oftentimes will work directly with political parties to assess whether or not they have particular barriers in their rules and in their culture that keep women from accessing leadership positions. We also work with elections and electoral processes to ensure that they're implemented in a way that ensures women participate as voters and candidates. And then we are addressing the sociocultural norms, which is the third barrier and one of the most important ones that have not been addressed.
Les États-Unis offrent pourtant un environnement qui est de nature à faciliter l'émergence de la gente féminine dans l'arène politique.
So I think that the United States, obviously coming out of the recent midterm elections, we saw a record number of women coming into elected office. That's exciting because when women come in higher numbers, they actually increase inclusion overall because women are not only half of the population, but they're half of every population. So we did not only just see women coming in at higher numbers in the United States, we saw African American women, American Indian women, and other diverse groups coming in with this, you know, increase in numbers of women. The environment in the United States is important in terms of creating an ecosystem for women's increased political participation. Women have access to education, women have access to financial independence and increasing financial resources. So that ecosystem in itself is a good example in terms of what needs to happen in an environment to increase women's ability to participate politically. That being said, a key lesson that I think that we've learned, especially since the 2016 presidential elections, is the key need to address sociocultural norms.
Toutefois, des raisons qui relèvent de la sociologie justifient encore une différence nette entre l'engagement politique des femmes et celui des hommes qui seraient plus aisés.
Well, there are a lot of differences between the way men and women participate in politics, and there are also a lot of differences in the barriers and opportunities that men and women face in terms of how they access political leadership. It's critical to take these types of barriers into consideration when we're trying to empower and increase women's political participation. So these include things like women's disproportionate responsibility for childcare and household labor in most countries in the world, which actually is a time burden on them and may prevent them from participating in politics in the same way that their male counterparts can. Financial independence is also a huge difference that we see. Men oftentimes are the ones in control of the financial resources and have more wealth than women, and so it's very difficult for women to access the resources necessary to run for office. And so one of the large differences we see is that women tend to experience violence in the form of physical violence, intimidation, sexual violence within their own political parties or within their homes to prevent or to control their political participation, whereas although men do experience political or electoral violence, it's oftentimes in the public sphere and not perpetrated by somebody in their own party or in their home.
Faut-il dès lors envisager aux États-Unis une politique de quotas, comme cela semble être le cas dans certains pays, pour obliger les partis politiques à tenir compte du genre lors des investitures à des fonctions électives?
You know, it's hard to say. I think it depends on the context, but if we have often worked with women leaders or in civil society or in politics who have tried to push for quotas because they consider the playing field as not being level. Women often don't have the same networks. They may not have the same access to financial resources as their male counterparts. So it's often more challenging for women to become candidates, to be accepted as candidates as well. So they may need an extra boost.
La femme américaine a pris conscience de l'importance qu'il y a à s'engager de manière active en politique.
I think it's critically important for women to be in politics. I think we have a totally different way of looking at things, and I think there needs to be balance from the way men look at things and women do. So I think women being in politics creates the balance that we need.
It's very important for women to engage in politics because it gives you the ability to control your future, your destiny, by policies and legislation that controls every aspect of your life. And you got to do it not just for yourself, but for your children and our future generations.
There has been some research done also that shows that if there are more women in politics, often issues, more social issues such as education, tend to get greater attention than if you don't have as many women present or represented. So that's and one reason. So having women's voices heard, we think, is important. And then just out of the notion that women's rights is human rights, so out of a concern for equality and equity also.
For me, I think it's very important because different people have very different perspectives and different life experiences. So many times the government funding that's needed for programs or the ways that laws need to change particularly are about the experiences that women have in their lives as people who have babies, as people who raise children, as people who face certain kinds of discrimination or violence. Women have unique experiences, and if our voices are not at the table, then those experiences won't be reflected in the laws or in the funding. But in addition to that, women have a very good collaborative way of working together. And when you have more women in elected office, government is less about fighting and competitiveness, and more about collaboration and compromise and coming to conclusions that benefit everyone. So it's good for both men and for women to have more women in government.
First, women's political participation is a civic and political right and a human right as enshrined in UN international laws and mechanisms. Secondly, we know that women's political participation leads to stronger, more sustainable, and peaceful democracies. So it's important for women to participate in politics so that democracy is maintained and is inclusive.
Le parcours reste cependant semé d'embûches. Il est loin d'être un long fleuve tranquille, encore plus pour les femmes issues des couches minoritaires.
Well, you know, women and people of color like myself, I am Asian American, have always had difficulty entering politics because it was controlled by those in power. So it took some time to be able to break into politics, but I did so by getting active in the I'm a Democrat, getting active in the Democratic Party, being part of a member of what they call the Montgomery County Democratic Central Committee, which is the Democratic machine in Montgomery County, and also, you know, working with community organizations on legislation that impact our different communities. And when the time came, there was an opening, I ran for it, and I had already established a foundation and network when I decided to run for the House.
Américaine et camerounaise mènent le même combat pour une plus grande présence sur la scène politique. Les féministes états-uniennes ont pris le problème à bras le corps. Elles donnent quelques astuces qui pourraient aider celles du Cameroun.
I would say to the women of Cameroon to don't sit back and let the men do it all. You've got to get in there and run for office and know that you can do it. Because it is possible. Anything is possible for the women of Cameroon.
My advice to the women of Cameroon, get involved. You can start at the local level. Get involved in politics. Get involved in your community. Run for office. Or if you don't run for office, support the candidates that will support your issues and be a champion for you and your families. That's what I offer advice for the women of Cameroon.
My advice to women in Cameroon would be, this is your right to vote. Exercise your right to vote. Educate yourself on the process to get registered and to vote. and educate yourself on the opportunities to run for office. So please, don't be shy, don't be scared, work through any fear that you have, and register to vote, vote, participate in the process. There are so many different opportunities. If you don't want to be a voice, you can observe, you can volunteer, you can help other candidates run for office and support their runs for office that most align with your values.
I would give some simple advice. I would say continue with your education. I believe that you have to be knowledgeable about what you want to do, so continue learning. Continue learning. Take chances. Take chances. I have a phrase, no guts, no glory. You don't show any guts. And if you take chances, you may lose, but you haven't really lost in the process because you have met more people, you have learned more, you have connected. So I think connectedness, connecting with people in groups, I think gives us additional strength. I think basically having confidence in yourself. And when I say that, I don't mean that you think only of yourself. But I think if you have confidence in yourself, you're going to show it in respecting other people. I think respect, touching other people, is critically important. I think kindness is important. Now that sounds trite, but if you are kind to people, they're going to be more open to your suggestions, and they're going to find more room for you in their lives and in what you're doing.
C'est cette confiance en soi qui permettra peut-être à une femme d'occuper un jour le bureau ovale de la Maison Blanche. I know a change.